Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome back to the 343industries.org community forum Let's Play of XCOM 2. My name is Redstar Rocket, and when I left you last time, we were just about to decide on a guerrilla operation. And while, when I finished the last video, I was leaning towards, I think, blocking this operation in East Africa, which is probably the most tactically pressing. The truth is, none of these dark events are particularly bad. Increasing the cost of recruits is potentially a little frustrating, but we're at a stage in the campaign where we haven't suffered any losses, so this isn't a particularly big issue for us. Alloy padding could be a little frustrating, but again, it only applies to certain units, and generally we're doing enough damage that a few points of armor here and there won't make a huge difference. And of course, West Asia, while this is arguably the worst of them, it is something we can control. So I think we might have a look at different rewards this time and make a decision based on that, and that's a nice luxury to have for once. So here we could get an engineer. And engineers are always very, very useful. However, here we'd be gaining close to 200 supplies, and supplies are of course really, really useful in basically any situation, whereas in East Africa, well, having a scientist would be nice. Ultimately, it's not going to make a huge difference to our campaign progress. Especially as from here, we could potentially take these supplies and we could use them to build a laboratory, which would allow us to assign some existing scientists, and that would overall probably provide a bigger increase anyway. So really here, it's a choice between, do we want a new engineer, or do we want some more supplies? A new scientist isn't really all that worthwhile. And while long-term, an engineer might be better, supplies would help us more in the short-term, as we could spend that on, again, a laboratory, we could use it to improve our facilities, we could even use it to build some new equipment. So I'm a little bit of a loss for this one. And for the first time in XCOM history, I think I may flip a coin on this, as I honestly don't know which of these would be the most beneficial to us. So flip a coin here. Heads will go for the engineer, tails will go for the supplies. Heads are going for the engineer. And we are blocking this avatar project here, which probably actually is a good idea. It'll give us a little bit more breathing room in the long term. It means we don't need to hit this facility here quite so soon.
Setting course for West Asia.
And of course, this is just a project to destroy a relay, so we can actually bring some snipers along on this mission type, which is pretty good. So let's have a look-see here. I think we will bring Kiko along on this one. We may give Morrigan a rest, however. I think we will give Morrigan a rest. We'll bring Gamble along. Even bring Yash for this one, as he hasn't really had a run out until this point. Now we're potentially a little low on demolitions abilities here, but that's not a huge issue. Bear in mind, we do have Twan, who can be very, very good when it comes to blowing stuff up, simply because he can armor pierce and he can run and gun. And of course, Ty does still have two grenades, which is always very, very useful. Let's see what else we've got. We do have a battle scanner and a plated vest. So a battle scanner, I think we'll probably... yeah. You know, actually, we may put this on Yash, just because we want to ensure he's got as much survivability as possible if he's going to be our pistolier. And giving Gamble a battle scanner is probably a good idea, simply because it'll enable us to keep up a little bit better. If he needs to move, he can just then throw a battle scanner and reveal the area ahead of us. So we can still scout to a degree without needing to worry about the lack of Morrigan here. Now, honestly, it's been a while since I've taken a squad with two snipers, so this is going to play very differently from my usual style, but overall, I'm not too worried about it here. Let's just check, do we have any weapon upgrades floating around? I think we might have one. No. But that's fine. Do we have any spare weapons lying around in the inventory? No, we're fine here. Okay, so, let's get started. A short journey.
We're picking up a steady stream of communications coming from a hidden alien comm relay uploading data to the Advent network from this region. We have to take advantage of every opportunity to disrupt the aliens' progress on their latest operation. So we're moving in to destroy the relay before they complete the transfer. Don't leave any hostiles standing.
And to me, this looks like the small town style set, which is actually really good, as by and large, the small town is pretty good for snipers. There's lots of nice wide open sidelines, but more importantly, there's good places to put your snipers where they can see the whole battlefield, which is, of course, hugely beneficial for a gamble. So this is Operation Winter God in Advent Patrol Zone 18, the outskirts of Novgorod. Let's get on with this.
Menace 1-5, the communications relay is up ahead. Move in and destroy the target.
Position is obscured.
And just looking at this from here, I think this is cover, so we could even put our snipers on this, and that would turn the mission into a cakewalk. That really would turn the mission into a cakewalk. Let's start by perhaps moving Twam to here. Or no, I think perhaps we'll put Tyrone over here, as he's got our grenades, and I think there's going to be a turret for me, a checkpoint here.
Heading there now. I've got enemy movement here.
And as expected, we've got a turret, we've got a squad. This isn't a big deal. And I would even be a little tempted to move T up to here, because that would put him in a good position to start blowing the stuff up, and then we do need, of course, to consider that turret. Because it's unlikely we'll kill that in turn, and of course, it's not hugely powerful, but it can still put a dent in someone. I think this is ground floor though, so this shouldn't be too hard to take out. We can probably, I think, just blow this wall here out, move someone up, and then we'll have, if we put both our snipers here, we'll have a lovely line of sight straight onto it. So we could potentially accomplish this mission in 5 turns, I'd say. Here's what we might do. We'd have a shot from here, so we may move up and chain shot that turret.
Moving to designated coordinates.
Which would completely shred its armor and actually probably blow it up outright. And we'll just pop Kiku over here for good measure as well.
Good to go.
I'd be a little hesitant, I think, perhaps, to put someone up here just yet. But on the other hand, it would be a good spot to launch an ambush, so perhaps that's something we can consider. Yeah. But we would have a good line of sight from up here, so
time down the motor.
We'll put our snipers on the roof just up there.
Stepping off.
I'm trying to think what we could do with T to get him closer. Perhaps we could put him here, but that would potentially expose him. As is, I don't think there's any way this squad can move far enough to reveal Ty. But we may overwatch just in case. And this spot is allegedly flanked by something, which is strange. I can't understand that, but let's not take the risk. Let's just be nice and cautious here. And what is the point of that gate there? That is a gate. I don't quite know why there's a gate there, but that is a gate.
Understood. Moving out.
And of course, we do have the frost bombs on blue, if we really need them. But for now, we'll just move to Overwatch.
Eyes on the prize.
Now, do flares break concealment or not? That's our question first and foremost. Let's check. Yes, this will break concealment. Now, I think you get an aim bonus when attacking from concealment, don't you? Or is that ranges only? That looks like it's probably ranges only, right. But with that in mind, we can probably shoot Ty last, realistically. So there we've got Sun Lancer Trooper Officer. An 87% chance, that's actually pretty good. And would potentially take him out of race. The odds of this would be good. Let's try this. Let's give this a try. If it works, it'll be a great way to open up. And it has hit. It's done some damage. Didn't kill him, but it's not a big deal. And there's that turret, which isn't a problem. Now, what abilities does Yash have? Can we check them anywhere? I can't remember if he has an ability which means that using a pistol as the first action no longer ends the turn. If he has that, that would be fantastic. If he doesn't have that, it's not the end of the world. For now, let's shoot this Stun Lancer. Yep, and that's a hit, that's good. And then we'll try a pistol shot. And if this doesn't hit, it's not the end of the world. Obviously, we'd rather it hit, but it's not a big deal if it doesn't. Mostly I'm doing this at this point because I just want to find out for certain whether or not this, whether Yash has this ability which allows him to shoot his pistol twice in a turn.
Enemy's down.
He does not. That's not a big deal. I'm a little nervous about just rushing forward with Twam here. Check what we've got left. We've got these four characters to move. Got one enemy down, one enemy wounded. So we need to get three kills in four moves, functionally. Or we need to consider using Mimic Beacon. And we do have to be careful about moving T up, as what I'd like to just put him there and jib this guy. Moving so forward does carry the risk of revealing something, as I expect there'll be something in that building there. We could of course move into here, but then if there's no cover around, he's dead. Actually, let's check. So Tyrone does have a shot on that advanced officer there. He has 83 aim, plus 23. Okay, 83 plus 23. That's a total of what, 106? So that'd be 79 plus 22, plus 30 from. I'm pretty sure we could get a guaranteed kill on. Oh, she has to check damage first. A staggering shot from Yoshi would probably be enough to finish that guy off, and then all we'd need to worry about is this guy here, but there's always the risk that we'd need to put a Mimic Beacon down. That does still leave us a Hebe. So perhaps we could move a Hebe to here, throw down a Flare, and then make decisions based on that. But then... No, ultimately, Twam has to be the one to move first here, because all decisions are going to be based on whether we reveal another pod or not, so we're going to move Twam first. And as expected, we have revealed another pod, which is really not great, but this is the kind of thing we can probably salvage. Or, I'd hope we can salvage at this point anyway. So let's move right up here with Tyrone, and then he can chain shot down this turret.
Moving to designated coordinates.
And this should kill outright unless we are staggeringly unlucky. And of course, stacking that armor shredding bonus is just fantastic. Absolutely fantastically useful. Now, how far could we throw this Mimic Beacon? Let's see. Not nearly far enough. So we'll just get Kiko as far forward as we can while trying to make sure everyone stays in cover. I think it'll be visible by all the enemies there. Not a big deal if not, but it should be visible by all enemies here. And of course it only needs to survive three attacks, which isn't a big deal.
Confirmed.
And then Blue, we'll see what we can do with the staggering shot. That'll probably be enough to, not quite enough to guarantee a hit on this guy, right. But a frost bomb, I don't know, to me that seems wasteful. So for now, let's go with a flare. And that seems like a good enough shot to me. And that, oh, of course, we need to staggering shot him, right. And all this needs to do is hit, so I think we'll be all right here. I had to say it. Right. We're approaching the end of our recording time here, so there will be a short break in the video in just a moment, so don't go anywhere, and I'll see you after the break. Hello and welcome back. And we've got a slightly odd choice here. Now, realistically, the Advent officer is actually probably a slightly bigger threat. I don't think they do more damage with their guns, but I think I'd prefer to have him shoot just because the Advent trooper will have slightly worse stats. So while this mission has already gone from ideal to far less than ideal, at this point the Mimic Beacon's in play, and we're just going to have to do the best we can. So let's hope we don't take any shots here, although we should be alright. And provided both the snakes shoot first, it's likely that the Codex will use its... Right, that's not good. And that's not good. We are going to take a round of fire here. However, I think we'd probably be okay with a bit of luck.
They get poisoned me.
Now, this actually isn't all that bad. Oh, damn. Yes, it is. I thought we'd get away without an injury there, because, of course, Ahivi does have that medikit. Yeah, he does have the medikit. That's not it. So this isn't a big deal. Obviously not great, but not world-ending either. And this doesn't say that he'd be poisoned from moving through, so I think we can probably safely assume he'd be okay. But first things first, let's start making plans with our snipers. Perhaps we should consider blowing out this cover here simply so that T can then put a crit on that Codex and finish it quickly. Yeah, let's see. We don't have any hugely good shots here. I think we'll shoot the Viper here just to be safe. And I think that's a kill, is it? Is that a kill? That's a kill. And Gamble does have a decent shot here. This potentially could kill it. We've got a, what, 30% chance of getting a kill here? We may as well. It's not like he can really do anything else this turn. Actually, can he throw far enough to... If we were to put him here, would he be able to throw far enough to get a grenade onto that piece of cover there? Yeah, I think if we move him here, he will be able to throw just far enough to blow out that cover there, and if not... Let's try this. This is either a very, very good decision or a very poor one. But without being able to know in advance how far we can throw a grenade, we can't be sure. That's fine. And for those wondering, yes, I am going to avoid hitting the Codex here, if I can. Oh, for God's sakes. And it hasn't blown it up, so that was actually a really, really poor decision. Right. But fear not. Now, we do have just a, we can get an instant kill on that snake there, which is good. We need to use blue to heal him, or... Actually, do we? We might get away with this still. Now, if we move to Kiko to... Right, there is poison here. Okay. I wonder why it's not affecting Ahivi then. Does he have an ability which blocks that? Is he just immune to it because he has the medkit? Thank you. Right, and we have to reconsider this now because this might just mean two injured soldiers instead of one. Okay, first things first. Let's take out this codex and just pray that this doesn't reveal another enemy squad. And of course we have another insurmountable hole in the wall here. Never mind.
Yes, sir.
And that should be a guaranteed kill there, so we'll worry about that in a minute. Let's move over here to here first. Is that rock burning? I thought it was a fence, but no, apparently that's just the rock burning there. At any rate, provided this crits, and I'm fairly confident it will, we should be alright. And if not, we can always finish it off with Kiko. Not that that's ever going to be an issue.
Nailed him!
And Ty's still poisoned, which obviously not great, but there's an aim penalty involved, right. And I may have put, oh no wait, that should still, allegedly that'll still provide some cover. Oh, that'll allow him to flank, so we'll start with Tyrone for the aim bonus. If we're lucky, it'll kill our right. Nah. So there shouldn't be too much of an issue here. As this is 100% a hit, so even minimum damage we're fine here. Although next turn we will have to heal Ty, as I really don't like having my soldiers be poisoned. But for now, let's finish off this codex. Or not. That's really, really concerning. We might actually be in trouble here now.
They're moving to flank me!
So we've got someone on Overwatch here. Not great. Let's see what Yoshi can do first. So let's try a shot from Yoshi. Yep, expected that much really. Okay, this just went from bad to really bad very, very, very quickly. Is Kiko poisoned there as well? Because he seems to be... No, we'll worry about this in a minute. Okay. Now this swirling mass of nastiness does explode if left unchecked, so... we do need to clear this as soon as possible. How on earth is he being poisoned? Right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to call down an evac point. We'll have Kiko throw a grenade onto this codex and then just evac him so he's not having to worry about being poisoned next turn.
Roger that.
Oh, shoot! I completely forgot that I'm an idiot, but fortunately apparently everyone's rolling really, really badly today, so not the issue it could be. Although of course we can't put down an evac zone for him, right, okay. Let's just try a regular grenade then and we'll have to evac Ty instead. Although if Ty's going, let's put down the evac point here.
Can I get an evac here?
We'll move him to the evac point. And then we'll have him blow up the entrance to the building before he leaves. Actually, no, first things first, what are the chances of... Yeah. Let's just slash this codex really quickly. And I didn't even consider the possibility there that... that might... reveal a pod. I'm getting reckless here, this is silly.
Okay. Moving out.
First things first. Let's open this building up. We'll just go for maximum collateral damage here so we can build ourselves a nice easy sight line toward that beacon. And then we'll evacuate Ty. Who's going to be slightly injured, but it's unlikely to be a serious issue.
We have visual.
Let's go.
And then just while we're waiting for that, we will heal up Kiko.
You'll be fine.
I don't understand how he's being poisoned there, though. I mean, certainly he wasn't suffering the imminent penalty last turn. So we'll just take a turn here to set our snipers up. We'll pull back everyone else back to better cover and reload.
On my way. Heading there now.
And to be honest, we may even just make a running retreat from this after this is over. We're already effectively a soldier down.
Rock and roll. We agreed together.
So it's probably not really worth right, hang on. I think we need to move Twan forward to provide vision here before we can we can just finish this off here easy enough.
We've confirmed destruction of the relay. The alien transmission is down. Eliminate any remaining hostiles and move to evac.
Now, can you have multiple extraction zones? Oh, it's on cooldown. How long for? Doesn't say. Right. Okay, for this turn, then, I think what we'll do is we'll just pull back.
Commander, sir.
We'll provide overwatch with Kiko and Blue.
Moving to overwatch.
Right, and we can just call that down whenever, that's fine. So if that's the case, perhaps we'll just move our snipers over here so that they're in a position to provide overwatch.
Good to go.
Once the enemy turns up.
Heading out. I'm on the move. Okay.
On my way.
And we'll make sure everyone who's in need of it gets a reload, which I think is probably just Yash.
Found something.
And we've got a bit of a choice here. This map is obviously quite long, and I'm not sure where this pod is. So I'm thinking we're just going to wait for them to come to us. This might take a little while. I apologize for that in advance. But I don't really see any reason to take any risks here. Especially when, you know, we can get away with not doing it.
Order's confirmed. On the move.
Please. And so what I think we'll do is we'll hold position until we spot something.
Come get some.
Found something.
So functionally from here, we're just going to repeat this until we see an enemy squad, so... Oh, nope, we'll reload. Gamble first. But until then, we're just going to keep these positions, so I'll put a break in the video and I'll cut it back in once we've seen what we're seeing. So don't go anywhere, I'll see you in a few moments, I suppose.
Overwatch. Moving to Overwatch. On Overwatch.
I'm on it.
Actually, what am I doing here? This is a stupid idea. We've got battle scanners. Let's just have a look, shall we? There we are. That's not so hard. So if we move up to here... As far as I'm aware, none of them can see that, so...
Moving out.
Yeah, let's just move everyone up.
On the move.
This isn't, strictly speaking, the most sensible way to do this.
Affirmative. Covering now.
But it'll make things, hopefully, significantly less boring. And we do at least know where that pod is now, so... We're also going
to
move Yash and Gamble up just to the front of that for the sake of simplicity. We're pushing the end of our recording time, so after this turn we'll put a short break in the video and we'll see what happens from there.
Overwatch.
Right. So it'll be a short break here. Don't go anywhere. I'll see you in just a moment for what will hopefully be a most exciting conclusion. Hello and welcome back. So we're going to expend our next battle scanner here, just throw this as far as we can. And that enemy pod doesn't even appear to be moving. But I think from my current position, our snipers... Right, I'm fairly certain they actually do have a line of sight here, but we'll just need to reveal them first. So with that in mind, I can probably bring Gamble back a bit, just out of range. Actually no, we'll put... I think Gamble's got the slightly better weapon, so we'll put Yash on this side as a sort of just-in-case measure. Although maybe we could have him run over this Outland Tower here. Or perhaps we could even just bring him up here, actually.
Go, go, go! Headed there now.
So this won't be quite so good in terms of his aim, but this isn't a good position if we move, as we'd be fighting from poor cover. So we might start by moving... we'll probably start by moving Yash up, and we may even just have him hunker down there, as really all we want to do with him is make sure we're getting a line of sight on the enemy.
On the move.
So having him hunkered down full cover is probably going to be an effective choice, or so we'd hope anyway. Then we could always go for a free lightning handshot. Let's see if we can wound that codex. If we can't kill it, it's not a big deal. But if we can wound it, that'll make its resulting clones a little bit easier for us to take out, and thus this Or should we take that risk? That is a risk, and it might be one we're taking for the sake of taking one and doing something interesting rather than because it's the tactically correct decision. The honest truth is, I don't really have a plan for this, and that's showing I've made a poor decision here. How far can we throw a frost bomb? Not quite far enough. Also, of course, this doesn't look like it's going to guarantee you actually take this wall out. Right, for now, I think we're going to hunker Yash down. And we'll hopefully chip a... What the end decrease? That's too much of an aim decrease. We'll hopefully chip away this advanced trooper here. We might kill it, I doubt it, but we might. Be nice if we do. A staggering shot on that codex, which would be pretty useful. Actually, I think that's all we'll do. I think we'll put a staggering shot on the codex. And that's unfortunate, as I don't think we have a good way we can engage that up. Well, indeed, any way we can engage that. Let's also... Actually, how much damage does Shadowkeeper do? Only 2 or 3, that's not enough for our purposes here. Perhaps an Overwatch would be the best tactic here. Actually, I'm probably looking at this wrong. We could probably just use a flare here.
Moving to designated position.
And of course, we do have a staggering shot, which we could use as well. So we'll put a flare on this thing. We'll use another staggering shot to finish it off, as ideally we don't want to end it with weapons jammed here. And of course that high cover is not great, but it's not the end of the world either, so let's go for this guy.
Enemy destroyed.
And when I'd like to just run Twam straight up and execute this shield bearer, I don't think that would be a particularly intelligent tactic. So we're going to move him up, hunker him down, ready for next turn. And then he'll spring forward and take one of these guys out. Unless he's suffering a weapon jam, but even then we could use his sword to take out the trooper. Oh, actually, can he see both of those? You know, let's just use Shadowfall and mop that trooper up. We're not saving it for anything.
Target disciple.
And with a little luck, that'll make the Codex less likely to block Kiko's weapon on this coming turn. I'm not sure if the clone suffers an action reduction. Never mind. Let's go for this codex here. And now all we need to do is deal with that shield bearer.
Got something over here.
Now we could try a slightly unorthodox tactic here. We could slash this guy, which would remove his overwatch, and then freeze bomb him. Which would allow us to clear the danger zone. Overwatch removed, which is what's important here. So we'll bring Blue up out of the danger zone. Or actually, no, come on. Let's be sensible about this. We'll move Yash to here, we'll blow that wall out, and then we'll just play it safe.
Okay.
Nah, lightning hands wouldn't serve any purpose here, so.
Throw a grenade!
There we go. And that hasn't actually taken out his cover. Right. Never mind. We'll try a pistol shot with Kiko. And if it hits him, it's nice. If it doesn't hit him, it's actually not a big deal. Are we still in that volume there? No. Let's just frostbomb this guy, not take any risks. There we go. And I'm not convinced he's out of the danger area there, so for now, we'll just be a bit cautious with our moving. And isn't he supposed to be frozen? I suppose that could just be a graphical glitch, maybe? At this point we can decide who gets the kill. So T already has one, so that's not wasted on him. And Gamble's got an easy shot, so... I do like high-ranking snipers, so at this point I think we'll get the kill for Gamble.
Status confirmed. All hostiles are down and the area is secure. Status confirmed. Mission accomplished.
So frankly, that was a bit scrappy there, if we're honest. The sensible tactical option probably would have been at the end to simply pull back. Once we'd finished the objective, we should have put down an evac zone and just left. Of course, I'm too bloodthirsty for my own good. And I think setting an overwatch trap actually would have been the right idea until we realised with those battle scanners that the enemy pod wasn't moving. So what I would have liked to do was have a concealed soldier, probably Morrigan for example, if we'd had her move up, give us a line of sight with our snipers and then just start raining fire down on them, set up another overwatch trap. But again, it's not the end of the world. We had one soldier wounded, and I think Tyrone only lightly wounded. I think he had two wounds on him there, so that's not a big deal. Double sniper style, as it turns out, probably not really one of my strengths, if we're truthful, but... While my past self who played on me within wouldn't have believed that, turns out that's how it is at XCom 2.
Glad to see our new recruits aren't hesitating when it comes to taking out the aliens.
Disappointing to see he's got 5 whole days and wounded rather than just lightly wounded there, but... not really a whole lot you can do with that, unfortunately. T does have a promotion at the very least, which is great. Free sword attacks on any enemies that enter or attack from melee range, that's pretty good. That is pretty good. And that would synergize well with Blade Master. But again, I feel this is like... this is something which is specifically built to counter things like Faceless and Chrysalids. And Stun Lances, and... I could also be wrong in this. but I think this triggers after their attack, so if you hit with something that disables you, it's not automatic. I may look that up before making a decision, actually. It's implacable would be very, very useful. Run and gun, move forward, take something out, and then fall back or fall the better cover. Would synergize very, very well. And Blade Storm is quite a situational thing, truth told. Whereas you can always find use for Implacable, so... We may wait before we make the decision there. I'll look it up between videos and I'll promote to you at the start of the next one. Picked up some decent loot there. I tend not to be a fan of hair triggers, simply because I don't find them hugely useful, as it's a chance-based thing rather than a guarantee thing. But more importantly, we've got an Illyrium core, and code experience are never a bad thing to have. We've also recovered our first advent turret, which is quite nice.
You have done an outstanding job leading the resistance, Commander.
And of course, we've got ourselves a brand new engineer, which is pretty great. So we've got a workshop and a power relay on the way. Additional comm station. How many supplies do we have? We can probably afford that.
Commander, we've pushed our current power systems to the limit. We don't have any capacity to spare, which means we can't expand our facilities further.
That said, perhaps we should start in on excavating this room here just for the extra supplies. As we do already have someone in the Proving Ground. Which is odd, because we don't appear to be building anything from it. Now that's a thought, actually. Our, what we should have done in this video, and didn't, is equip the spider suit and the exosuit, and both of those would have proved invaluable during that last mission. So that's a silly mistake on my part. We'll make sure to correct that next time. For now, let's head back to the geoscape and have a look around. Let's empty this first. Unless there's a project we particularly need. Plasma grenades actually could be quite useful. I think we will upgrade to plasma grenades here, actually.
Sounds good, Commander. I'll let you know as soon as the project is ready for deployment.
And that'll take us 5 days. So that should complete about the same time the power relay down here is done. So then we can assign those two perhaps to excavating down here. Which would take 3 engineers, so perhaps we'll give that a miss. And we're going to acquire yet another engineer over there, which would be great. But first things first, we'll collect the Furies
Avenger
here.
Plotting new course.
Finish off the Zero Alloys. And then what do we need more? Supplies or engineers? Well, more engineers are never a bad thing, put it that way. Although we are about to finish the workshop, so that would be less mandatory. Never mind.
Strategic resource located.
So, Furies. Sweeping the area revealed little on the surface, but sensor readings indicated something buried nearby, and we used high explosives to uncover the object. Once the dust settled, our team found several alien stasis pods buried among the remnants of what was once a heavily reinforced structure, and quickly broke them down into raw materials. This is of course a little callback to the Furies mission in XCom Enemy Within. A little sad to find out what became of them, but there you go. And we've lost the supplies there, so... Bit of a shame, but what can you do? Now here we could also potentially start making contact in the US. The continent bonus is pretty cool, which is quite good. What have we have here? Spare parts. Proving Grounds Codgers. Just right. Under the table, what's this? 50% more supplies for selling things, right. That would cost us 125 supplies, which isn't bad. Or we could spend 40 intel. And of course, we do have room for more resistance contacts at the moment, so... That would take 2 to 4 days. Making contact here would take 3 to 5 days, so... Perhaps I'll make contact with West Africa here. Oh, plus 5 to Avenger Power. We should probably start making contact with Europe. In that case. So what we'll do is we'll make contact with West Africa. We'll build a transponder here, or the transponder there. Then we'll move into Europe, and that we'll be able to access America from both sides.
Setting course for the West African sector.
Is having extra power in the Avengers never a bad thing?
Attempting to establish local regional contact.
I do not think I could have predicted this outcome, though it is intriguing.
And we've recovered 45 intel there, which I think is just enough to pay for the cost of reviewing that area. So, Advent Datapad decryption, codename Bletchley, presumably after Bletchley Park. Completed June 4th, 2035. The Advent Datapad is a basic field unit designed for storing and transferring intelligence that the aliens seem otherwise incapable of disseminating through their various communication networks. Although some effort was required to interpret the alien file system and decrypt their data, it seems as though Advent purposefully kept the device's overall function relatively simple. The evidence is a little more than circumstantial, but the design of these systems could be some indication of the lower-ranking Advent troops' overall mental acuity, outside of designated tactical scenarios, signed Tigan. So what to move on to next? I think we might do the turret breakdown, as I think you gain an improved gremlin from this, so we'll do that now.
The turrets we see employed by Advent throughout their various facilities and security checkpoints are automated, much in the same way the alien mechanized units are. A significant amount of time was likely spent developing the optical sensors and targeting system, which I expect Shin will want to thoroughly examine following the disassembly process.
So what we'll do is we'll head back to the world box.
The aliens have considerable resources at their disposal, but we've still managed to do reasonably well against them, despite our own limitations.
And we'll put a short break in the video here as we're approaching the end of our recording time, so don't go anywhere. I'll see you in just a moment. Hello and welcome back. There we go. This isn't such a bad one, really. I mean, obviously, dark events are never good for us, but of the options we had available, that's not really grand as well.
Reading you loud and clear.
New regional contacts located.
Sissel grants us an extra, what is that, 28 supplies. This would only grant us 25, so this is also the best option just from a spending perspective for our supply drop.
I am sure you will find the results to be as intriguing as I do, Commander.
But first, some research to complete.
Advent doesn't seem to have any issues stationing completely autonomous weapons in close proximity to the people in those cities. Really shows you how much they care.
This is the Advent Turret Breakdown, codename Acolyte, completed June 6, 2035. We've run across the Advent Turrets in a variety of places, mainly near the security checkpoints and other areas they're trying to lock down. Now that we've finally gotten the chance to pull one apart, I can say with certainty that the turrets are operating entirely on their own, with no outside controller or remote direction given. As much as I'd like to test the targeting sensors, Central and Dr. Tigan have both expressed concerns about test-firing the system before we know how it discerns between friendly and hostile targets. Considering how close the aliens' positions or that how close the aliens position these things to civilian-occupied areas. The target recognition software must be incredibly accurate or incredibly basic. I wouldn't be all that surprised if the aliens were just flipping the switch and setting them loose on anyone caught in the firing radius. I'll have to see about setting up some sort of test environment, signed Shen. And this gives us the defense matrix, which of course is really, really useful for Avenger defense missions, if we hadn't had one about 20 seconds into the campaign, anyway. May consider getting this. I don't think I've ever had two Avenger defences in a campaign before, but I suppose it's hypothetically possible. Certainly I've seen nothing to the contrary, so we might consider that. But for now, we've got all these ones to do, so let's start, I think, with the plasma rifle.
I had assumed you'd make that research a priority, Commander. I'll notify you as soon as the report is available.
Thank you.
Power relay now operational.
Excellent. So we'll take one of our engineers, pop them in there. And are we building a workshop here?
Yeah.
We may knock this power relay here down. We'll just knock that down, that gives us a bit more room to expand. And we are getting a little loan supplies, but again, that's not a huge deal just for the moment. And we do, of course, now have a spare engineer we can pop in there. I don't think we can get a... We don't quite have the technology at this point, I think, for the Illyrium conduit. Or is that a supply issue? At any rate, it's not a big deal. So for the moment, let's cancel that there. And how many spare engineers do we have? This is one day off being finished, it's not an issue. So let's see. I think this one we gained some supplies from, so we're just going to start clearing this out. And then as soon as the workshop's finished, we'll, actually, what's our power situation? We could probably unstaff Dr. Taylor and have him start clearing that out as well. We're a bit more limited in terms of power now, but this will be done a bit more quickly, which is something. And then, of course, we can have the workshop gremlins just move to staff that, so this actually shouldn't be too much of an issue. There we go. Advanced explosives, that's great. And I think this is things like the gas grenade and stuff, which is... they're generally pretty cool, but they're not necessarily what I'd want. The skull mining as well is one I've just never really used, truth told. I'm sure it's pretty useful, but I've just never gotten around to it, so might give that a miss. What's important now is that we do have... plasma grenades, which are a bit more powerful.
Hello, Commander.
And I think we've already done the mutual autopsy, so just thinking... what is it you use to unlock the improved grenade launcher? There we go. Now, the advanced grenade launcher, I think improves grenade explosion radius. But more importantly, lets you throw them further, so we'll definitely be going with that. It's quite expensive, but we can afford it, and we are close to our next supply drop.
I saw Tyler himself in one of the corridors. I'm not sure he even noticed me. Bradford trusts him, but I'm still keeping my eyes open.
So we'll finish this, and then we'll start making contact with Western Europe. Or not, right. So we have an advent retaliation mission here. Operation Little Calm. I imagine there will be Little Calm in the middle of a retaliation mission. And this is New India. So we'll just do this next time. It hopefully won't be too much of a nightmare. I can't remember, did we have berserkers in the last retaliation or not? I thought we were going to have them in one of the previous ones, but I can't remember if this is the last one they showed up or whether I'm thinking of another one of my campaigns. At any rate, we'll almost certainly have berserkers in this one. They actually aren't... if I'm truthful, I don't think they're quite as bad as they were in Enemy Unknown and Enemy Within. In this, they're a lot more tolerable. At any rate, I hope you'll join me next time when we take on Operation Little Calm in New India. Hopefully I'll remember to actually equip all of our new equipment, including the spider suit and the exosuit. So, until then, my name is Red Star Rocket, thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you next time. Till then, take care, and goodbye.